Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the initial clinic of the day. I am Dr. Vikram, Vohra, and I have got with me Dr. Vanna from Share India and Dr. Ananya, the AIT doctor in our institute. Now, today is a very interesting discussion. Today we are going to have with us Dr. Swati, Naik, who is the head and department of radiology at Batra Hospital and Medical Research Center in New Delhi. She will be talking about X-ray interpretations in the X-ray chest in patients who are suffering from active tuberculosis. Before we go for that, we will first have the poll for attendance for the day. I will request you to kindly hurry up with the polls today because this X-ray session is going to be very interesting and may invoke some discussion. Kindly fill up your polls, please. I will request all of you to kindly observe the etiquette of the clinic. Please keep your mics at mute. Now, in today's session, we will be dealing with both the northern and the southern part of the country. That is, we have got with us UP, Delhi, Andhra and Tamil Nadu. So, the presentation of the day, it will be in English so that everybody is able to understand. Now, we are finishing off with the poll and I would now request for the poll on the topic to be put up for the day. Mr. Ajit. Okay, so we are ending this pre-trials topic poll. And I would now invite Dr. Swati Naik to kindly take up the didactic.
Can you hear me?
Yes, now we can hear you. Thank you.
Okay. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Dr. Swati Naik. I'm currently heading the Batra Hospital and Medical Research Center in Department of Radiology. And the topic of discussion today would be the chest X-ray findings in active tuberculosis. Chest X-ray is the most common radiological investigation across the globe, and it forms the cornerstone of radiological diagnosis for chest.
Yeah.
So as I was talking about, the chest X-ray is the most common radiological investigation across the globe, and it is the cornerstone of radiological investigation for the chest diseases. The chest X-ray is so useful because it's a low-cost investigation and is available very easily. Also, it has a high spatial resolution, and technically it's a simple technique to do a chest X-ray. The standard use for chest radiography that are employed are the PA view, the AP view and the lateral view. There are other views as well, but mainly these three standard views are commonly used. Next slide. Now, as you all know, tuberculosis is a very common global health problem, especially in our country. And the current diagnosis of TB requires the demonstration of AFB bacilli in the sputum sphere. Chest X-ray is done as an initial investigation in patients suspected to be having TB. It is also done in case there are unexplained symptoms like weight loss, expectoration, etc. Also, chest X-ray is done for the diagnosis and follow-up for sputum positive cases. But if the chest X-ray findings and the lab parameters are discordant, it's better to do a CT because a CT of the chest will give us a global comprehensive view of the lungs as well as the lymph nodes and pleura. Next. Tubercular affliction of the chest is divided into pulmonary TB when the lungs are affected. Or it can be called the extra pulmonary TB if it involves the pleura or the lymph nodes. Next. So classically, we are all aware of that TB is divided into the primary form or the post-primary. The radiological manifestations of primary and post-primary are quite different, but obviously there's a considerable overlap in the primary tubercular finding in the chest and the post-primary TB. So while primary tuberculosis infection is characterized by lymph nodal involvement with few parenchymal infiltrates, in the post-primary form of TB, we have extensive parenchymal involvement along with cavitation, fibrosis, and scar formation. Next. Primary TB occurs, go back please. So primary TB is occurs due to the inhalation of airborne mycobacteria and in unsensitized individuals, And classically, it is divided into four types. It is of four types. The ganglio-pulmonary TB, the tubercular pleuritis, the miliary TB, or the tracheobronchial form of TB. Let me just tell you that only the ganglio-pulmonary form of primary TB is characteristic for primary. Rest, all the other forms, the tubercular and pleuritis, the miliary TB, and the tracheobronchial TB, these can be seen in the post-primary form as well. Next. One more. Yeah. So coming to the ganglio-pulmonary pattern of primary TB, it is characterized by the presence of mediastinal and hilar lymph nodes. The prevalence of adenopathy, it decreases with age. So we have more than 90% of the children showing hilar enlargement in primary TB, while in adults, it's only 40% of the adults who show nodal enlargement. The most commonly lymph nodes that are affected by primary TB are the right paratracheal, the hilar, and the subcarinal. Other nodal stations may be involved, but these are the most common sites. In approximately 30% of the cases, the adenopathy can be bilateral, and in another 10%, the chest x-ray may be normal, though the patient is infected. So in this x-ray, are you able to see the x-ray clearly? There is widening of the paratracheal stripe. There is also hilar adenopathy. This is more marked on the left side. The left hilar lymph node appears bulky. And there is subtle parenchymal infiltration, which is seen in the left upper lobe and in the perihilar region on the left side. There is also a pleural effusion on the left side, which is causing obliteration of the CP angle on the left. Next. The primary parenchymal focus of infection in the chest is known as the Ghon's focus. It is on the same side as the nodal enlargement and is located in a peripheral subpleural location. The combination of the parenchymal focus, the Ghon focus, and the lymph node along with the draining lymphatic is known as the primary complex of Ranke or the Ranke's complex. If we come to the adult manifestations of primary TB, there is more of consolidation and parenchymal involvement and less of nodal involvement if adults are affected with primary TB. Okay, next. So, primary TB, in most of the cases, the infection is self-limiting and patients remain asymptomatic. The only sequelae after that is the presence of few calcified nodular densities in the lung parenchyma along with the lymph nodes which may or may not be calcified. However, in some cases, there may be complications because of the primary nodal enlargement. There may be presence of retro-obstructive pneumonitis. This occurs due to the extrinsic compression of the airways by the enlarged lymph nodes. As you can see in this x-ray on the right-hand side, there is widening of the paratracheal stripe, which represents paratracheal lymphadenopathy. There is also presence of hilar lymphadenopathy and some density is also seen in the suprahilar region on the right side. A wedge-shaped opacity is seen abutting the cardiac silhouette on the right side in the right paracardiac region. This represents an area of segmental collapse or consolidation in the right paracardiac region. Next. The enlarged lymph nodes in the mediastinum or the hilum, they can persist for a long time and they continue to be seen on the chest x-ray even after the completion of ATT or adequate disease response. This is a chest x-ray of a child. It is showing showing widening of the paratracheal stripes on both the sides. It's more marked on the left side. And this is the X-ray A. This is the pre-treatment X-ray. And the X-ray B, that is the post-treatment X-ray. So, though there is significant resolution in the dimensions of the lymph nodes, the nodal enlargement continues to be seen. This is the CT of the same patient. On CT, the lymph nodes are better characterized and they appear as conglomerated lesions with low attenuated centers. This low attenuation in the central portion is because of the caseation necrosis. Next. Coming to the second form, that is the post-primary form of TB, this occurs mainly due to reactivation in approximately 90% of the cases, or it may be in a minority of the patient, it may be due to the reinfection. Approximately 5 to 10% of primary TB patients go on to develop progressive primary TB because of hematogenous dissemination of the disease. Like I said earlier, the primary TB is characterized by predominantly nodal enlargement, while in the post-primary form of TB, the main findings on the chest X-ray are pulmonary or parenchymal in nature. So, post-primary TB is characterized by liquefaction of caseous necrosis, formation of cavities, progressive fibrosis, which causes lung destruction, and bronchogenic spread of disease. Next. So, the infection in the post-primary TB, it starts as an area of consolidation. It is in the upper lobe, mostly affecting the epicoposterior segments of the upper lobe or the basal or the superior segments of the lower lobe. Initially, there is an area of consolidation which consists of caseous necrosis. Gradually, there is liquefaction of this area of consolidation, and as the communication with airway develops, there is formation of cavities. Due to the cuffing, there is further bronchogenic spread of infection and other lung zones are affected. So this is the X-ray. It is showing an area of opacity in the right upper mid zone. You can also see some amount of fluid level. This is an area which is showing impending cavitary changes and liquefaction in the center portion of the lesion. Next. Imaging in post-primary TB shows extensive abnormalities in predetermined locations in the lung field. And an active the radiological findings of post-primary TB, they are dominated by active endobronchial infection. You can see areas of consolidation, as you can see in the region on the left upper mid zone, the area of consolidation, which is visible as an area of airspace opacification. Multiple acinar opacities can be seen, as seen in the mid zone, again on the left side. Finer nodules, yes. And there may be presence of larger nodules as well, the so-called clustered nodules, further more towards the left pericardiac region, yes. Endobronchial infection can also be manifested as tree in bud opacities on CT, where we see them as linear branching V or Y-shaped opacities because of the endobronchial infection. Next. Another common manifestation of post-primary TB is the presence of cavitary lesions in the chest X-ray. The cavities, in fact, so much so that cavities are considered a hallmark of reactivation, and they are seen in approximately 40% of patients. The wall of the cavity may be thin and smooth, or it may be thick and nodular. So this X-ray, the PA X-ray on the left-hand side, it shows multiple cavities in both the upper lobes, upper zones, the one on the left. Yeah. That is suggestive of
Dr. Swati, can you hear?
Yeah, I can hear you now.
Okay.
If the wall of the cavities is thick and nodular, that is highly suggestive of an active infection, especially if surrounding region shows the presence of consolidation. So this lateral chest x-ray, it shows cavities with surrounding consolidation, which is seen as an area of airspace opacification with air bronchograms within. Yes, approximately 10% of the cavities can have air fluid levels. Okay, next. Now, coming to the healing phase of the post-primary TB. Healing in the post-primary form of TB, it occurs mainly with fibrosis and calcifications. Because of this fibrosis, there are multiple areas of architectural distortion, cicatricial bronchiectasis, volume loss, fibroparenchymal densities, etc. The unaffected areas of the lungs, predominantly the lower lobes, there is compensatory emphysema in the regions which are not affected by TB. All the other fibrotic sequelae, such as the pulling up of the diaphragm, the diaphragmatic tenting, and hilar retraction, etc., also may be seen in healed lesions of TB. Next. So again, to reiterate, the primary TB, it presents mainly as a mediastinal lymph nodal enlargement with few parenchymal abnormalities, while the post-primary form is manifested mainly by parenchymal densities and evidence of endobronchial infection, cavitation, and fibrosis. The other forms, such as the miliary TB, the pleural involvement by TB, the tracheobronchial TB or tuberculomas, they can be seen both in the primary as well as the post-primary form of disease. Next. This is an X-ray of another manifestation we come across in our day-to-day practice, the miliary TB. Miliary TB occurs due to the hematogenous dissemination of infection. And the X-ray findings are very classical. It consists of multiple tiny, discrete or fluffy nodular opacities spread randomly across both the lung fields and showing a more or less uniform pattern of distribution. Can you see the chest X-ray? There are multiple tiny nodular densities. The nodules are generally in the range of 1 to 3 millimeters, right? And in approximately 25 to 40% of miliary TB patients, the chest X-ray can also be normal. And a CT is a better modality to pick up the miliary mottling of chest. Next. Can you go one slide more ahead? Yes, yeah. So tubercular involvement of the pleural involvement of the pleural involvement is one of the most common manifestation of extrapulmonary TB, and it is seen in both primary as well as the post-primary form, but it is more common in the primary TB. Go back, please. Yes. So in primary TB, the effusion is generally large. It is unilateral and it is a free pleural effusion, as opposed to a post-primary pleural effusion. In the post-primary form of TB, the effusion is generally smaller in volume and it's loculated and contains internal debris. There is also a difference in the pathogenesis of the pleural effusion in the primary form as opposed to the post-primary form. In primary form, the effusion is generally a manifestation of delayed hypersensitivity and it occurs 3 to 6 months after the initial infection. While in the post-primary form, which is characterized by cavitatory changes, the effusion generally occurs because of the erosion of the cavity into a pleural space. And so it is smaller in volume and contains multiple septations, loculations, and internal debris. In the primary form, the effusion is generally sterile because it is a manifestation of delayed hypersensitivity. While in the post-primary, mycobacteria can be isolated from the pleural aspirate. Okay, next. Go one more slide ahead. Yes. Coming to the tuberculomas, oftentimes we see multiple persistent nodules in the chest X-ray. these nodules can be variable in their size ranges. They can be subcentimetric or they can be even larger, and they can even reach larger sizes of approximately 5 to 6 centimeters. These are the tuberculomas, and they are also seen in both primary as well as the post-primary form of TB. But they are more common in the healed primary lesions. Calcification is common in approximately 30% of tuberculomas, and another 10 to 50% of tuberculomas may show internal cavitary changes. A characteristic finding of tuberculomas is the presence of satellite nodules in the surrounding lung. This is also better seen on CT. Tuberculomas can persist for long durations, and they continue to be seen in the chest X-rays even after completion of ATT. Next. So after a brief review of the radiological manifestations of primary and the post-primary disease, we come to the most important question, that is to assess the disease activity. Let me just point it out at the outset that the radiological modalities like the chest X-ray and the CT, they serve to detect and localize the disease. And based on the site and morphology of the radiological findings, a diagnosis of active TB may be suggested. But for a definitive diagnosis of active TB, it still requires the isolation and identification of mycobacteria, especially if the clinical findings and the lab parameters are equivocal. Next. Okay, one more. Go ahead, please. Oops, yeah. So active infection in tuberculosis is manifested mainly by consolidation, acinar nodules, thick-walled cavities, clustered nodules or miliary nodules, and presence of pleural effusion. Next. Next. Yeah. So as you can see in the slide in the center, there is an area of consolidation, and this consolidation is generally seen in the lung epiphyses or in the upper lobes, and there is also presence of ipsilateral or locoregional lymphadenopathy. Multiple nodules are also visible in the mid zone and in the paracardiac region. Yeah, again, CT is more sensitive to pick up and further characterize the areas of consolidation. And on CT, these areas of consolidation are generally peribronchial or subpleural location. If the consolidation is multifocal and is involving many lung segments, the chances of AFB positivity are more. Next. Yeah, this slide, it again shows the presence of consolidation in the right upper and mid zone, and there is some infiltration in the left lung field also. Next. Another common manifestation of active tuberculosis infection is the presence of acinar nodules. These acinar nodules are ill-defined fluffy nodular opacities with a tendency to coalesce, and they represent the bronchogenic spread of disease. The chest X-ray, it's showing multiple fluffy, tiny and variable size nodular densities. And on CT, they are seen as areas of tree in bud. Next. Clustered nodules. Clustered nodules are also a manifestation of active tuberculosis infection. The clustered nodules are generally larger than the acinar nodules, and they also show a tendency to coalesce with ill-defined margins. In the chest X-ray, which is put up here, there's an area of non-homogeneous pacification in the left mid-zone, yeah, in the pericardiac region. There is also some internal cavitation within this region. In the surrounding areas also, and on the right side as well, multiple nodular opacities with ill-defined margins are noted. Yeah, these are the so-called areas of clustered nodules. Next. Yeah. Both these x-rays again demonstrate the presence of nodular cluster nodules. If you see the one on the left, it's showing multiple nodular opacities and masses more in the upper and the mid zones in the paracardiac region, paramediastinal, no, the opposite one. Yeah, this one, yes. There are multiple nodules more marked in the on the right side, and multiple nodules are also seen on the left side, yes. And because of these coalescence of these nodules, a paracardiac opacity is noted, right? So areas of subsegmental consolidation also can form because of the confluence of these nodular opacities or masses. Next. Miliary mottling we already discussed. Multiple tiny, discrete or fluffy nodular densities showing a random distribution. This is in contrast with the other forms of TB which show an upper lobe predominance. Here the miliary mottling is generally uniform throughout the lung fields. In fact, a basal predominance may be noted. This is because of the gravity dependent blood flow to the lower zones of the chest. And miliary mottling, as we all know, it's because of the hematogenous spread of infection. Next. Yeah, this X-ray again demonstrates a common finding of active TB, that is the presence of effusion or empyema. It could be a large effusion as in primary TB, or it could be a small loculated empyema as generally seen in the post-primary form. So the pleural effusion can also present with pleural thickening, and the pleural thickening may also get calcified in due course of time, which is a marker for healed TB. So this X-ray is also showing the presence of effusion with some non-homogeneous opacities in the surrounding lung field. Yes. Yeah. Next. After that, so many a times the X-ray findings are not so classical to be classified as the active form of disease. Yeah, but we definitely, if you are seeing an abnormality, but you are not sure whether it's TB, or if you are sure that it's TB, but if you are not sure whether it's active or not, then the X-ray is termed as indeterminate for the presence of active TB. These indeterminate X-ray findings for tuberculosis include consolidation without ipsilateral adenopathy. If you see an area of consolidation, but if there are no significant lymph nodes in the locoregional regions, then that becomes an indeterminate finding for tuberculosis. Or if you see imaging findings of active endobronchial infection in non-typical locations, that is if not necessarily the upper and the mid zones are affected. Or if you see imaging findings of active endobronchial infection with the presence of tubercular sequelae. For example, if you see cavities, if you see thin wall cavities with infiltrates in the surrounding region, it may represent a reactivation of TB, or it may also represent any other endobronchial infection, not necessarily TB. So these findings will put the X-ray in the indeterminate range. And right. If you see thick walled cavities with air fluid levels, these air fluid levels could again be a marker for reactivation, or they could even represent any superimposed infection. Similarly, if you see bilateral lymph node enlargement, or if you see bilateral hilar lymphadenopathy, which is commonly seen as sarcoidosis or lymphoma. Similarly, bilateral pleural effusion is generally non-infective in etiology. It generally occurs due to congestive changes and serositis, etc. Next. These are some of the X-rays I've put up to highlight the points I've just mentioned. The first X-ray here, yes. The first X-ray, yeah, yes. It shows an area of consolidation. And as with all TB cases, the consolidation is seen in the right upper and mid zone. But there is no significant adenopathy in the hilum, in the hilar region or the paratracheal region. So this would classify the X-ray as indeterminate for TB. Similarly, the second X-ray, yes, that's the one. It shows cardiomegaly, the heart is enlarged. There's also obliteration of both CP angles, which is suggestive of bilateral pleural effusion, and there are multiple reticulonodular markings in both the lung fields. So presence of a bilateral pleural effusion with reticulonodular marking and cardiomegaly, this x-ray is also indeterminate for TB. In fact, it looks more like congestive changes or because of congestive cardiac failure, right? So the third x-ray here, yes, it shows bilateral hilar adenopathy. Both the hilar regions are quite bulky. This is also atypical for TB, and this is commonly seen in other granulomatous diseases like sarcoidosis, or it could even be a manifestation of lymphoproliferative or lymphoma, right? The fourth x-ray here down, yeah, it's showing multiple reticulonodular markings, and these markings are not in the upper or mid zone, which would have been the case in TB. The reticulonodular markings and the interstitial markings are more prominent in the lung bases. Yes. So this also makes it indeterminate for TB. This is not classical. Yes, something is abnormal, that is sure, but it doesn't make it, doesn't classify this to be put as active tuberculosis infection. Next. Yes. So this x-ray, the one with the cavities, the one on the right side, yes. It is showing sequelae of TB. You can see, the opposite, the other one. Yes, yes. There are multiple fibroparenchymal densities in the right upper and the mid zone. And there are also multiple cavities. The wall of the cavities is thick and nodular, but there is a large air fluid level in one of the cavities. So this air fluid level, it could be a manifestation of reactivation TB, or it could even represent any other infection, not necessarily TB. So this also makes the x-ray indeterminate for TB. The other x-ray, yes, yes, that's the one. It shows multiple nodular densities and few of the nodules, and a large cavity is also present in the left lung field. Yes. The nodular densities, they also reveal areas of cavitation, and few of them appear homogeneous as well. But the presence of cavitation also makes it indeterminate, because this kind of x-ray could be seen in malignancy or even disseminated fungal diseases of the chest. So there are many findings which make the finding of tuberculosis on the chest x-ray difficult. In such difficult cases or indeterminate cases, it's always advisable to do a chest CT, because the chest CT gives us a global view. It gives us a comprehensive view of the lymph nodes of the mediastinum and the pleura. Obviously, the lab parameters have to be taken into account. Next. So the healed phase of TB also has characteristic radiological findings. There are areas of bronchovascular distortion, fibroparenchymal densities, cicatricial and fibrobronchiectatic changes with areas of scarring and band formations. The tubercular cavities may persist as thin-walled cavities for long duration, and they continue to be seen in chest x-rays for a very long time. Many a time there is fungal colonization of the cavities, the so-called fungal ball appearance, where we see a soft tissue density within a thin walled cavity, or the aspergilloma formation. This aspergilloma, it can also calcify, and it can be seen as an area of calcification within a cavitary lesion. Next. Okay, go back please. One more slide back. Yes. So in the X-ray A, yes, there are few linear atelectatic bands seen in the left perihilar region. There is also a thin walled cavity in the upper zone on the left side. So this X-ray is sufficient enough, the radiological findings are sufficient enough to be called as a healed tuberculosis, right? This is a CT of a patient. It is showing thin wall, yes. It is showing thin wall cavities in the right upper zone. The other X-ray C, the one marked C, yes, it's showing areas of volume loss in both the upper zone and the apical regions. Yes, there is pulling up of the hilum on both the sides with hilar retraction, and few fibrotic septae are also noted in the perihilar regions on both the sides. Yes. So, and this one, the last CT, the FF. Yes, that is. It's showing multiple thin walled cavities with volume loss on the left side, in the left paracardiac region. Yes. There's also ipsilateral cardiomediastinal pull. As you can see, the heart is also pulled towards the region. And this suggests fibrotic changes or the fibrocicatricial changes. Next. Yeah, we discussed that one. Next. Yes. Yes, go back, please. Yes. This is the finding, the X-ray findings in healed tuberculosis patients. The tubercular nodules in the lungs, they may become calcified and they can be seen as linear or nodular areas of calcifications. The lymph nodes afflicted by TB also become calcified and can persist in the chest X-ray for a long time. This is a CT of the same patient. It's showing multiple densely calcified mediastinal lymph nodes. Yes. And also areas of parenchymal calcifications. Yes. On the left side. Yes, that's it. Okay, next. As we all know, fibrosis and calcifications are hallmarks of healed TB. So this is an X-ray. It's showing dense pleural calcification, dense sheet-like calcifications in the pleura. This is suggestive of old healed calcified empyema. This chest X-ray, it's showing multiple nodular calcified densities in the right upper zone and the mid zone. There is also volume loss on the right side. So this is also significant. The findings are suitable enough to be classified as healed tuberculosis. Next. That's it. So basically, if you see an abnormality on chest and if it has radiological proof enough to be called as active infection, that's okay. But if the findings are in the indeterminate range, it's always better to go in for a CECT of the chest. I would like to reiterate that a CECT is more important because it would add to the accuracy of the findings and also lead to a global view of the mediastinum and the pleura.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Swati. I think it's an interesting topic and it's a vast topic as well. So very brief, you tried to explain us the things, and I hope the audience and our participants, the ERT centers, must have been benefited by this. I know this is not the major one, like in one go. Dr. Nani, I think you also would say yes, agree to it.
She covered it very wonderfully, all the stages of TB. Just one thing I would like to add. Because we are dealing with TB, HIV patients here. So one thing we cannot forget is that immune suppression. So when we have TB, HIV, when we have HIV patient and we are suspecting TB in them, so 6 out of 10 times we see very atypical findings on chest X-ray. These are very typical findings that ma'am just talked about. That's because our immunity plays a role and we have cavities on the X-ray. And these are like for normal population. This is the real picture. This is a stereotype X-ray that we can get. But for HIV patients, if the CD4 is well preserved, like 500 or over 350, we can get such pictures. But most of the time, when the CD4 counts falls below 300, then it's very difficult for body to mount such an immune response that will make cavities. So most of the time we just see fluffy alveolar shadows on the x-rays, and our suspicion has to, we have to lower our threshold, you know. We cannot say, oh, there's no cavity, we are not suspecting TB. We have to be very, very suspicious of TB in HIV when it comes to HIV-TB, because they don't have that immune response to mount such a picture radiological.
Right.
That's a take-home point that we should remember.
Thank you, Dr. Ananya. And I think now it's time to go on the post poll. The questions, the same questions which we have attempted in the first one when we started the session. So you must be seeing these three questions on your screen now. So let's see if there are any changes of the responses which you have made earlier. I request you all, please attempt these questions. Thank you all for doing the post poll. And now I request you all to fill the feedback. The questions of the feedback are here on your screen now. And with that, we are here ending the session of today's e-NISCHIT clinic. So I thank Dr. Swati. Thank you so much, ma'am, for coming and briefing us on the chest X-ray infiltration in active TB patients. And then I thank you, Dr. Nanya, for being with us. Dr. Vohra, thank you. To him also, sir had to leave because of some urgent, you know, work. And I thank everyone here who has been with us today for the clinic. So see you next time, next week in next e-NISCHIT clinic. And again, as we discussed, please subscribe to the channel. There, the people are waving bye for us right now. Okay, thank you, everyone.